Started that early.
Yes, I think so. Oh, that's weird.
Because it's a nice prelude.
Yeah, you're good. Yes. Excellent.
The Lord be with you.
And also
There are a number of things we want to remind you about. First of all, we are thankful for Janet stepping up and playing the piano today, for Robert filling in for Ron today. It seems there are a number of folks that are under the weather this morning. So we pray for their healing, but thankful for folks that are helping us to worship. You will know again that the pew pads are in the rows, and we want to make sure you fill them out. And just a reminder that the last person getting them needs to tear them out and put them in the offering plate. That's the way they're getting upstairs for our records. We do have a congregational meeting next Sunday. Next Sunday after worship, we will be gathering together to elect our new officers, our elders, and our deacons. And likewise, we will be hearing about the USCBS survey, the survey we just took, and we have the results, and we will be sharing them with you. It is our intention to have slides giving those, as well as having them printed for those who want to look at them later. Finally, we want you to know that there will be a potluck next Sunday. And following the service, we will be sharing a meal together. There are sign-ups in the back for that. Likewise, this week, we are initiating what the session has chosen for us to do. We will be having a weekly communication. An email will go out each week sharing with you the articles and the items that we want you to be aware of, letting you know of the events in the following week. And bear with us as we put this together and find our way in this process. If you want something included, it needs to be in the office by 9 o'clock on Tuesday morning. So if you want anything in the weekly communication, get it to us by Tuesday mornings at 9. Then let us share the peace of, Julie, you have something.
My announcement is in regard to the young man who's living at Family Promise. There's a family with two children and also a young man who is a senior at Kelso High School. He's set to graduate very soon here. He is attending a Washington university in the fall. I can't remember which one. Working two jobs to make that happen in addition to the scholarship help that he's receiving. Anyway, Family Promise is planning a graduation party for him. I think it's going to be June 22nd, and more information will come. But I posted on the bulletin board in the hallway the address for Family Promise if any of you would like to send him a graduation card. I think given all that he's been through and all that he's doing and what lies ahead for him, to let him know that he has a community behind him would be a lovely thing. If you want to give the cards to me or to Ron, we can make sure that they get there, or you can post them to Family Promise Attention. His name is Makoa, and it's written down outside. So thanks for thinking about him and holding him in your hearts.
Thank you, Julie. Also, we want you to note that your talents, gifts, and offerings that have been shared on the cards have been hung. They will continue to do so each week. And so we ask you again to fill those out and put those in the offering plate as well. Now, the peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ be with everybody.
With you as well.
Hey, Darcy, peace of Christ be with you.
And with you, John.
Oh, shoot.
How are you feeling?
I'm fine. It's just my allergies kicked up today, so.
A lot of people on Zoom today. Wow.
Yeah, it's.
Hi, Jim. Hi, Judy.
Good morning, John. It's good to see you.
Peace of Christ be with both of you.
Peace of Christ to you.
Bless you, brother. Bless you, sister.
We're all the walking wounded this morning, I think.
Yeah, it looks that way.
Well, mine's just my allergies kicked up, and I figured my fellow congregants don't want to hear like sneezing, hacking, and coughing during the service.
No. No. You're a wise woman.
How's the weather in Kalama?
It's just starting to rain.
Just starting to rain? Wow.
Yeah.
We're supposed to get a lot of rain.
Which is, there is a balm in Gilead. Please stand as you are able.
Please join me in the call to worship. God calls us and we respond. We come before God awake and alert to God's voice. We come expecting hope realized in faith. Our opening hymn this morning is number 41, O Worship the King, All Glorious Above. Please stand.
Oh, worship.
I ask you, are you attentive to God's presence in your life? When God calls you, even as God called Samuel, do you hear the message and receive it? We are too often afraid, like Samuel, that it is something else, someone else beckoning us. We are often unwilling to entertain that God is speaking. God's voice is for us. We often ignore it, neglect it, and sometimes oppose it. But God is involved in our lives in such key and amazing ways. We know that this is true. So we come before God, confessing and asking for God's forgiveness. Pray with me the prayer as printed in our bulletins. Let us pray. God of creation. We are told that our sins are as far as the east is from the west and the north is from the south. So too will our iniquities be cast away. All our iniquities are forgiven. All our transgressions are blotted out. So we can be sure that through Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Amen.
Please listen to the prayer for illumination. Loving God, the source of our joy, as we turn our hearts toward your word, we ask that you would soften us, soften the calluses on our hearts, weave yourself in between the cracks in our spirits, and plant hope where there is room. And as you do this, like flowers toward the sun, we will turn ourselves toward you, eager to hear a word so good that we cannot help but be moved by your spirit. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from 1 Samuel, and it's chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Let us listen to what God has to tell us. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call you. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." This is the word of the Lord.
Our gospel from the book of Mark, the second chapter, verses 23 to chapter 3, verse 6. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food? How he entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which it is not lawful for any but the priests to eat. And he gave some to his companions." Then he said to the Pharisees, "The Sabbath was made for humankind, and not humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath." Again, he entered the synagogue, and a man was there who had a withered hand. They were watching him to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, "Come forward." Then he said to them, "Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save life or to kill?" But they were silent. He looked around at them with anger. He was grieved at their hardness of heart and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out, and immediately they conspired with the Herodians against him, how to destroy him. This is the word of the Lord. I am a little bit torn this morning because the sermon I have prepared this last week is very long. I tried over and over again to reduce it and cut things out, but they were too critical for the word. So I stand here torn whether to preach from the heart a different message that is much briefer, or to preach what I have prepared. I still don't know. Let me suggest something. Last week, I shared with you about string theory. I shared with you about the very, very, very tiniest of molecules and particles in nature, in reality, in what is here. And I shared with you the depth of understanding that continues to elude us. There may be even smaller things than the strings that we attribute to life. I shared M-theory because the understanding and knowledge about strings were diverse. There were five particular views of string theory that were contradictory to one another, that were not the same, but were diverse. And M-theory says
They're all correct. They're all true. They're all right. People came up to me after worship last Sunday and said how interesting that was, how thought-provoking it was, how it stirred some mental images that they had. So today, as promised last week, I want to look at theology. I want to look at the emerging theologies, the theologies of the past, and the theologies that are all around us. And I want to do so because I don't want to just say there are 7 or 8 different theologies and my conclusion is, but rather I think it's important in this context to share about some of the major theologies in the church today. If you hadn't noticed, I'm working at the long sermon at this point, because it's difficult to be brief about each of the theologies, but I will keep mindful of that, and I will share with you that if I get long-winded, which rarely happens, I will cut the message in half and preach the other half next week. So you'll need to come back if you want to hear the complete understanding of our faith. But theology has come from the past. It has come from centuries of experience with God. And it is important to understand that and to realize what has been shared over the years. Just as we had our mission study, and you know the first thing we did as we gathered together was George and a number of other folks shared about the beginnings of our church. And they are unique. Many churches didn't start the way we did, but we started faithfully, and we started with concerns about social justice. We started with gathering people together in connection, and we shared with one another in worship and prayer and singing. And we realize, as we've gone through this process, that God is still calling us to that. And as the mission study report gets done, they are looking at reflecting what we had told us and what we had told one another. Historically, we talk about orthodoxy. We talk about the orthodox understanding of faith. Orthodoxy, simply put, is assertions, dogmas, understandings of God that are propositions and that are told that they are irrefutable, undeniable, and absolutely true. Such things as omniscience, the understanding that God knows all, has known all, and will always know all. That is one of the propositions that is shared from time past. Another one is omnipresence, that God is constantly here. God is constantly everywhere. There is nowhere that is apart from God. And then omnipotence. We believe in a powerful God, a God that determines and decides and implements what God wants, what God desires, what God chooses. And we believe in an all-loving God, a God that is compassionate, a God that embraces us, a God that is there for us regardless of what we face and regardless of what we see. Many of these are undeniable. Many of these are truths that we would embrace. They are things that we believe about God. But orthodoxy came under criticism and some understanding that it didn't hold, and some analysis, as you've probably heard, the long and completely attested controversy about how can God be all powerful? How can God be so able to affect all of life and allow evil, allow sin, allow destruction and death and warfare and conflict? Doesn't that go against being an all-loving God? Being all-loving and caring? So challenges emerged, and there were many things that were questioned. There were many things that were concerning, and there were many things that were held debatable and in conflict, unresolvable. And so neo-orthodoxy emerged. Neo-Orthodoxy was taking those old tenets and applying them to modern experience, to current understandings. You see, and it is important to realize, and we'll talk about next week because I'm going on too long, I will talk next week about the other theologies and what emerges in that context. But Neo-Orthodoxy, again, shared some understandings, shared some rules, shared some dogmas about the faith. And they did so in the current understandings because, and this is key, this is important to realize, all theologies come out of the culture. All theologies come out of our experience. All theologies come out of our reasoning. And so they emerge in this process. And so the neo-orthodoxies were just a new set of dogmas, a new set of perceptions, a new set of rules and determinations and absolutes about the faith. In this process over the years, about 50, maybe 60 or 70 years ago, emerged liberation theology. Liberation theology, as you may be aware, is understanding this context of all of Scripture, of all of faith, being tied to some essential truth, that God came to release the captives, that God came to care and provide for the hungry, that God came for sharing and assisting those in poverty, that God came for those who were hurting and alienated, and God came to restore them and connect them with the life of the fellowship of the disciples, which is us. And God came so that those things might be addressed. And that happened from the beginning of time and is continually happening today. That God comes urging us to be people who care for those who are on the margins, those who too often are excluded. Providing again a dogma that is set on principles that are unquestionable and undeniable. So we have orthodoxy, we have neo-orthodoxy, and we have liberation theology. From that process, and during my early formation in seminary and my early ministry, and a part of this church's history is feminism as a theology. Feminist theology came to being. The realization that gender does not exclude us from power. Gender does not deny us from full inclusion. Gender does not identify us as something other, but rather gender has all people equal. All people are identified as being a part of the grace of God. You can't help but read the Old Testament. And what is it about? It is about the kings. It is about the prophets. It is about the early people of faith like Moses and Aaron, about Samuel, that we heard about a little while ago, and Eli, the chief priest, and it's about all these men. There are some, and it is identifiable, there are some women shown in the context of the history of our faith, but the prominence, the predominance of male men in power, influence, and presentation. I wish Joe was here to say amen, because she is one of the ones I know who heartily embraces feminist theology. Feminist theology then sees the whole context of the scriptures in light of gender inclusion, participation, and acceptance. Those are the primary neo-Orthodox perceptions of our faith. Those are the tenets that are proposed as true for all of us. But there are a number more. There are a number of others as well. So let me try to continue just a little bit longer, because the next theology came out of what I talked about last week. It came out of understanding the very being of life, of all matter, of everything that is, in this scientific discovery of strings and atoms and subatomic particles and all these things. And at the base of that, at the very heart of that, is that there is movement, there is vibration. There is this realization of energy. And as we understand that energy makes up everything, and that it is in the way that it is connected, it is the way of the relationships, those atoms working together, that constitute everything that is. Water is H2O. All of us probably learned that from our youth. It is the molecules that were continued to be together as certain protons and electrons that made up water. And it is so in everything, ourselves included, that all is in that relationship of life and understanding. And so process theology says that's true in science, says that is what is the case, but it's also the case for faith. It's also the case for understanding who we are in God. It's also the case for everything that is godly and understand from that perspective. It's all about relationship. Relationship to each other, relationship to God. And they can say, and they can identify, everything throughout the scripture is about relationship. It is about relationship. So the theology then emerges and says, this is what is primordial. This is what is clear from the very smallest and tiniest perception of the world. It's all about relationship, how we interact, how we are connected with one another and with God. There are some more exciting theologies that I could expand on right now, but I'll wait. Hard as it is for me to do, I will wait and share those with you next week. Do you want to hear one of those that I am intrigued with? Existential phenomenology theology. Say that with me. Existential phenomenal theology. Yes, that is an amazing perception of life, and it is amazing perception of faith, and I am eager to share with that with you, but I'll wait, and we'll do that next week, along with a couple other perspectives that inform our faith, help us understand who we are in relationship to God and in relationship to one another. I want us to bring this to a head as we look at our scriptures today, as we look at the message that happened in the Old Testament. Samuel was being called by God, and Samuel couldn't understand it. He couldn't get his head around it. He couldn't even realize it, because he only saw things in earthly terms. And so he goes to Eli and he says, "You called me. What do you want?" And Eli says, "I didn't call you. Go back to bed and don't disturb me. I'm trying to sleep." And it happens again. Samuel. And Samuel says, "Here I am." But he goes to Eli and he says, "What did you want?" And Eli, after some time, realizes that God is calling Samuel. And he says, "Samuel, next time you hear your voice called, stop and again say, 'Here I am,' but instead say, 'Here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord.'" And we know that he did so, and God chose him. God selected him. And there is an amazing history with that, and we'll see perhaps how that unfolds in the weeks ahead as well. But the voice of God in Samuel's life was extremely significant, was powerful, and moved him to do the things he did throughout his ministry. We are all called like Samuel. When we write down those things on those cards, it means we realize God has called us. God wants to use us. God wants to be involved in us in this world. And we identify them and we give them to God. And we say, in essence, "Help me do this. Help me do this. Here am I. Use me." There is so much more that is being shared in the scriptures that is important for us to hear. But I'll just share one more thing, and that is the beginning of the passage of Mark, which it says Jesus and his disciples were in the field and they started harvesting the grain on Sabbath. The dogma, the rule, was you don't do that. That is against the tenets of the faith. You are disobeying and being rebellious and opposing God. And Jesus says, guess what? It's not about the rules. It's not about the tenets. It's not about the dogmas. It's about life. And if it is so that David was so precious to God, he was able to enter the temple, the place of God, and to take what was only for the priests and eat, and those with him to be nourished. So it is that the Sabbath is not for humans, but humans or for the Sabbath. That is our understanding of faith. That is the teaching of Christ. And that is the word for us today. Amen.
Haven't guessed, we're singing "I the Lord of Sea and Sky," hymn number 69. I have heard my people cry,
Let us take time to hear God calling. Even as we are called by God and we listen for God's voice, so we know that God listens to us and God hears our cries and God hears us as we share with one another those things we bring to this moment. Are there things you would have us pray for this week?
I'm going to start us today because I feel a special blessing today. I spent the day yesterday with Ron Marshall for a presbytery meeting, and he said, I might not be at church tomorrow, but I'm not sure. This morning I got a message that he was not going to make it. He has fallen ill. He's not got COVID, he guarantees me. It sounds like a cold. But he also announced that Noel was not going to be here. So I'm a little bit of panic. I'm like, oh my gosh, I know I'm going to lead the singing. Oh my gosh, is it going to be a cappella? Because that's where we're at. And the blessing of this church steps forward. Right. Where'd she go? Right, there she is. She overheard me begging Debbie and trying to figure out something else and just comes right up and says, I'll play. Talk about this hymn coming true.
God, in your grace.
This is Jan. The girls and I went to visit Carla Gates in the hospital. She had to have emergency surgery last weekend, and it was very serious. She wasn't sure she was going to make it, but she is doing well. She was very glad that we were there to visit, and she said to let the congregation know that prayers are working and that she feels that she is not alone and that we are there with her. So continued prayers for Carla.
God in your grace.
I'd like some prayers for my father, Ken Freese. He came down with a blood infection about 2.5 weeks ago and is recovering from it and doing okay, but he is 99 and has some other issues. I'll be going to Seattle tomorrow to take part in a care conference with my brother and two of my sisters to kind of help Dad make some decisions about where he's going to be living next. And anyway, ask prayers for healing and for wisdom and just for us. Thank you.
God, in your grace.
Good morning. I'm Jenny, but pretend I sound like Darcy. This prayer request comes from Darcy online. She says that her boss, Haley, and her family is in mourning from a recent passing of her grandmother. If you please keep the family in prayers. And also pray that our administration will quit sending arms to Israel.
God, in your grace.
I'm Sharon. This is a season of change for so many kids. Graduations all over the place. I don't know if some of you have caught snippets of various people speaking and so forth, but I am just grateful for what I've been hearing. Lots of hope, lots of determination, lots of anticipation. Yesterday we were privileged to tune in on our grandniece's graduation in Texas from a high school that had 1,140 seniors, and Kimball Rose Gould is valedictorian. And we loved her speech, but we also love those of all these kids who are looking forward, and we're just grateful that we hope for them the future will hold greater peace and a greater sense of mission and security in their lives. So that's my prayer today.
God in your grace.
Hi, I'm Julie. I'm going to tag on what Sharon said. It was like she was reading my mind. I have a prayer for all the educators at this time of year who have worked so diligently and so hard to get all of their students to the place they are right now. As they look back, I think sometimes they feel that they haven't quite hit the mark, and I just want to hold those people who spend their lives and their time and their energy and go above and beyond every single day that they walk through the school doors, that they are enough, that they have done the best they can do, and we can't ask more of them, and pray that they can see and feel the differences they're making in those late young lives.
God, in your grace. Let us continue to pray. One more. Oh, we have one more? All right, Alan.
Good morning, I'm Alan. I would like prayers for our country's judicial system and our system of government, that it be respected, that these traditions, these long traditions, are so in jeopardy these days. And I pray that we can, as a nation, move forward with truth.
God, in your grace. Anyone else? All right. Let us then continue. Gracious and loving God, we gather in this space in body and in spirit and in presence, as generations have gathered before us and will gather long after we are gone. We come as a searching people, not an arrogant or prideful people. We come looking for you and searching for you in the depths of our souls, because your love called us here. Perhaps earlier today we imagined the warm welcome of faithful ushers, the well-worn path to the pew, the instrumental beloved hymns, a faithful word. We came because your love called us here. Perhaps earlier today, a sob closed our throat, a sob of wrenching guilt, a sob of bewilderment at a sudden life transition, a sob of paralyzing anguish, a sob of living in a world full of hate and division, a sob for our friends and loved ones suffering and in pain. We may have froze. Then your breath nudged our breath. Your spirit moved within and around us. We came because your love called us here. Perhaps earlier today, we wondered, how could entering a room full of strangers and friends or turning on a computer screen make us feel less alone? Isn't this just one more place we don't belong? Then your word spoke in our hearts. You did not choose me, but I chose you. We came because your love called us here. So God, as you have called us, We pray together, even as your Son Jesus taught his disciples and us to pray, saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Let us give our gifts to God.
Praise Christ, all people here below.
Gracious God, you have called us and we have heard you. We are thankful that we can respond to those around us and to those in our hearts that need your compassion and love. God, we continue to give to you all our resources, all our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The communion hymn number 507, Come to the Table of Grace.
Come.
everyone is welcome to this table. Those of all nations and ethnicity belong and are welcome. Those of all gender identity and sexual orientation belong and are welcome. Those of all creeds and understandings and theologies belong and are welcome. Therefore, know and believe you are welcome to this table. So then, in this ancient and enduring prayer of the church, we give thanks for all God's mighty acts in the past, present, and future. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We praise you, O God, for in your creating power and providential care, in making the world, establishing the covenant, giving the law, speaking truth through prophets, showing mercy in spite of our sin, and above all, through the gift of Jesus Christ, we have found our lives and expressions beyond words or thoughts. So, gracious God, we acknowledge and bow before you, proclaiming and embracing you. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. With thanksgiving, we remember Christ's birth, life and ministry, his death and resurrection, his ascension to reign, and the promise of his return. With thanksgiving, we remember the gift of the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, recalling the institution of the Lord's Supper in the context of our lives. Through this sacrament, you help us by establishing this meal as a joyful feast. With gratitude, we offer our lives to you, O God, even as Samuel offered his life in service and praise. And so we come, celebrating this holy meal. We are certain and we are aware that great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We call upon the Holy Spirit to draw us into the communion with Christ, to nourish us in Christ's body, to make us one with Christ and with the church everywhere, to keep us faithful in ministry, and to hasten the coming of the reign of God. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forevermore. Amen. So we gather here. We know that we belong. We know that we are one of Christ's disciples. And we know that he said, remember, remember what took place the night he was betrayed. Remember that after washing the feet of his disciples, he sat down and he took the bread. And he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to them. And he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when they had finished supper, he took the cup, and again, after giving thanks, he poured it. And he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, you show forth my death until I come again. I invite those to come forward who are serving with me. Again, we just want to remind you of the process that we are going to share in the bread and the juice, and what you are called forward to do is to come and get either the wine or the grape juice or the grapes and take it back to your seats, and we will take the elements together. Of this you can be absolutely certain. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Eat all of it. In the same manner, he said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Cut off from me, you can do nothing. Drink all of it. And they sang a hymn and went out.
Actually start singing the hymn. The hymn number is hymn number 746, Send Me, Jesus. And we'll wait a minute for them to finish gathering the cups. Just play the melody. Do you want me to? Okay. Send me, Lord. Send me, Jesus. 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 Send me, Jesus, send me, Lord. Lead me, Jesus, lead me, Jesus. Fill me, Jesus, lead me, Lord. Fill me, Jesus, fill me, Jesus. Fill me, Jesus. First verse again. That's a good idea, Janet. Send me, Jesus. Send me, Jesus. Lead me, Jesus. Send me, Lord.
So I have been given a note for prayer. And I'd like us to include it in our service today. Jennifer, our office assistant, administrative assistant, Jennifer, who is here at the church, shares with us that her family are now going as they prepare to say goodbye to her brother, Matt. And he has terminal cancer, as we know, and could pass at any time. So God, in your grace, what an amazing day to be with God, to be close to God, to be used by God. In that regard, we are gathered here. We are gathered together. And now may the grace of God, the love and fellowship of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the power, the hope, and the joy which is through God's Spirit be in us now and forevermore. Amen.